it back, but it's more than basic. It's a portion of his rap, but the core is ancient. It's important like a pack of some warm observations. They're important like the fact that we're bored of fake shit. More creative, have the floor, so take it. Travel to the core is a normal placement. Tattoos on my arm and a...
So I love Texas more than most people love their parents. But I will abandon this state over this weather. I cannot keep putting on a sweatshirt, a sweater, a t-shirt, and an undershirt, and three pairs of pants, and then going outside and needing all those layers in the shade, and having to need a bathing suit in the sun. Like, that's not how I grew up. That's not how I was raised. And that is not how the weather's supposed to be. I don't know if it's climate change. I don't know if it's a sign of the times. I don't know if Jesus just hates me. But it cannot go on this way, people. We got to get this shit straightened out. We got to pick a season and go with that season. Here in the Hidden Village, it's still a great day. And you're with Tattoo with Children. I am your host, Flavor Rated, in seat A. Across from me in seat B is Dread Pirate Benjamin, and across from us both is a man who appreciates the civilization and the amenities thereof, CIO, No Pain.
That's accurate.
Guys, it's been an interesting few days here. Look, I came at you hot last time. This is episode 42. Episode 41 was a little bit stiff. Okay.
Yeah. Was it?
It was. I'm told.
I haven't listened to it.
I'm told that I was a little excited.
Okay.
I take my criticisms very seriously, and so I'm going to slow it down.
Sure.
And propose a topic.
All right.
The topic I propose is happiness. And what are the things that make us happy? And do we do those things?
So, to really get into the conversation, I think we have to start with the origin of the word, which predates Latin. The word we're talking about is happiness.
Happiness, yes, that's the one.
I forget what the language is. There was something before Farsi.
Sanskrit.
Sanskrit, yeah. So we're going to go with Sanskrit. And
Syrian Aramaic, I think it was.
Really?
No, I have no idea.
So the origin of the word happiness was actually... Right after Adam and Eve left the garden.
Right.
Okay. If you recall, Adam and Eve were in the garden.
Yeah.
And they were happy.
Right.
But they didn't know they were happy.
No, they had no clue.
You know, they were just like there.
They didn't have the juxtaposition of the pain of life.
Right, right. Mm-hmm. So they were just doing things, I guess. I don't know. I get really confused by that part of the story.
From my understanding, what they did was Adam named shit.
Mm-hmm.
And then they like ate fruit and then fucked.
Okay.
Like every day.
Okay.
Fruit, fuck, naming shit.
Yeah, and that's fine, but it's not fine if you don't remember it.
No, yeah.
You don't have any aware that that's what you're doing.
If you don't know that's what you're doing, and this is great, then it's like, you know, it's just Tuesday.
Right, so, and this is really my only, this is one of the good parts about Pirate Benjamin, is that I know all these stories, and I can repeat them so that you can pass them down to your children, and so on and so forth.
This is still for the kids. Still for the kids.
So right after, there was a little shake-up in the garden, and after that shake-up, Adam and Eve were asked to leave.
Right.
I always assumed it was because they didn't pay rent on time.
Yeah, it seems more likely than they were beguiled by a snake.
Right, yeah, that doesn't seem accurate at all.
That doesn't seem accurate.
It does sound like a story like your crackhead neighbor would tell you.
Right, yeah, right. Exactly. Like, what have you been smoking? Well, there was a snake in an apple, bro. I'm sure there was. But we're going to go with they didn't pay rent on time. They got evicted. And they became aware upon leaving their residence that they were not clothed. They began, awareness began to dawn on them.
I think at that point they were clothed in fig leaves.
Okay.
Which got, by the way, fig leaves are not that big.
Right, and they're also not comfortable.
And they're not comfortable. They're so uncomfortable.
These Israeli friends that we used to live next door to in Memphis, they would make food out of fig leaves.
Uh-huh.
And it was terrible.
It's...
I mean, to all my Israeli listeners out there, I'm sure it's fine. It's probably better than fine.
Like, there's a reason why Jesus cursed the fig tree.
If you grew up in the desert, I'm certain
it was probably delicious.
A fig leaf is delicious.
Same with grape leaves.
Right.
Like, people keep making food and wrapping it in grape leaves.
Yeah, those are the Greeks.
But it's
Jesus
but it's fucking,
fuck, that is not good food.
No, and it's also scratchy.
It's, yes.
I don't like eating scratchy food.
It's
people, if you have to tell other people that it's an acquired taste, just...
It's just not good
just
food.
Just not good, yeah.
So they're wearing these scratchy leaves, and as men are prone to do, Adam took his off.
Yeah.
And they're, you know, Eve is already clearly, you know, she's like, look, this is life. This is pain.
Right.
You know, we got evicted. I'm going to be pissed off at Adam for, like, I don't know, the next 100 years. So I'm going to keep wearing these scratchy leaves.
Right.
Because he's going to want to, you know, do the thing later.
And I'm not going to let him see nothing.
Fuck him. I ain't going to let him see nothing. I ain't going to let him touch nothing. And if I do take these scratchy leaves off, I want it to be, like, red and inflamed. You know? Like, fuck you.
So, yeah, pet that angry cat.
Yeah. So... So Adam, fuck. Adam, though, being a man, could not, fundamentally, he could not take the pain. He probably made it.
Not.
He probably made it like 30 yards.
Dude, have you, if any man out there, have you ever like driven a long distance with like something scratching your balls? Like you got like a little like a tag on your underwear or like a mm-hmm. you know just like a small piece mm-hmm. of grit or something.
The right. answer is no.
Dude, you
the
have
answer
not.
Is no, because I would have stopped as soon
you
as humanly possible on the side of the road and adjusted my nutsack.
So Adam exactly. and Eve are walking along, and they make it about 30 yards, and Eve is still fucking pissed, man. She is pissed. She's not even speaking to him, you know? They go 30 whole yards, and he's like, I don't know why she's mad at me. I'm trying to figure out right now.
Ain't this her fault?
Didn't
you start this shit?
Right. Right. I'm not good at paying bills on time. Like, how was I supposed to know if rent was due on the first of the month? Like, you know, and he's going through all this in his head, but, like, he's got these scratchy leaves he's wearing around his junk. And so he stops, and Eve is like, what the fuck now? Like, she's still not speaking to him.
Right.
You know, there have been no words.
She just stops and turns and gives him
she
that
just,
look.
She just, yeah, that look where you think about dying. You know, you're like, taking a bullet couldn't be that bad because I don't know what this look means, but it's not good.
It's not good.
And so he's like looking at her as he removes the fig leaf, right?
Yeah, he goes, honey, I'm just taking the
right.
fig leaf
it's
off. It's scratchy.
Right, and he's trying to explain, and she takes one look, and she goes, ha, penis.
And then she's good.
And the word happiness was born.
And the word happiness was born.
Ha, penis in Sanskrit is happiness.
And that's...
And all women have learned, whenever they see a penis, to say that in that tone, and they literally feel happy.
It's all good
it's
after
a,
that.
It's a ridiculous member.
And now, now I feel, you know, completely exposed.
Mm-hmm.
And vulnerable,
mm-hmm.
and you know, the penis is shrinking because of the extreme embarrassment.
Yeah, you had this nice, decent looking thing attached to the front of you, but it's losing size. It seems to be intent on inverting.
It's retreating.
Right, and your lady or in question is just laughing hilariously.
She's having a big old time. Yeah,
she's just dying.
And this was all worth it now.
And so that, I think it's important, though, that we pass these stories down to our children so that the children understand when they what they're experiencing when it happens.
Right.
You know, and
the first time my daughter looked at, look at that thing.
Yeah, right.
Aren't you cute? Bless your heart.
Bless your, is it going away?
Oh. The first time she eviscerates a motherfucker like that?
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah, she's gonna know.
And all the boys out there need to understand that it is gonna happen. I mean, this is a myth. This is one of the things that it happens countless. It's a rite of passage in a way.
Indeed. So, it's a rite of passage almost every day.
So the next time you think of happiness, besides the rest of the podcast, because we're gonna talk about happiness, I want you to think ha penis.
I think that's one of the greatest bedtime stories you can tell your children.
Yeah.
You know, like, and it's biblical, which makes it okay
right.
to tell in the schools.
Mike,
go ahead.
Mike is dying.
You gotta bring that to your first grade class.
I wasn't even vaping.
Look, if we can't do things for the children, then why are we here? This is Tattooed with Children.
Yeah.
We're giving you the necessary tools.
To be a good parent.
To be a good parent.
We just want you to succeed like we're succeeding.
Oh, God. I couldn't keep it for that one.
And I think happiness is such a good topic.
So, happiness is a great topic because this is one of the because what people tell me is that I need to express my happiness more often.
Okay.
Because look, the truth is I'm not a miserable, angry person. I'm actually a very fulfilled person. Individual. Like, I'm just not. By the way, I do say this a lot. I say a lot. Okay.
Do you?
I say, I really do. Like, going through the listen back to the podcast, like, man, I do say that a lot. Here's the thing that you may not know. Here's a confession from Flavor Ray. I have a speech pattern commonly referred to in America as a stutter, referred to in Great Britain and the greater parts as a stammer.
Mm-hmm.
So when I was a kid, I could barely get a word out without stumbling over myself. And so I spent 3 or 4 years adjusting that pattern. So what you're hearing when I say is actually not a pause for me finding a word. It's me pausing to make sure the word comes out.
Mm.
Okay, so like adjusting that is very difficult for me. Like adjusting the actual pause and is very difficult because my brain doesn't work the other way.
See, I learned something new today.
So yeah, I apologize for the and all that. I think I could probably fix that in editing, but
we don't do that.
We don't do that. Yeah. We give this to you raw. So you just gotta take this ear dicking, baby. I'm sorry.
I learned today that me and Flavor Ray are stutter brothers.
I didn't know that.
Yeah, I have trouble with specific areas. R's especially are really bad.
I used to be really bad about G's, R's, and D's. D's gave me a lot of trouble.
D's give a lot of people trouble.
Oh, we all went there at the same time.
I didn't. I've never had trouble talking. It's actually the only thing I'm good at. Since I was like 6 months old, I've been talking and I haven't stopped and I'm 40.
Yeah, that makes sense.
But you've never had a problem with the D?
No, I've never had a problem with anything. I mean, if it involves my mouth, I can literally keep talking.
I'm not sure I'm comfortable with where this is going.
I can't stop. It's the way I got in trouble. It's the way I got out of trouble. It's the way I got through trouble.
I think it's one of the things that makes you happy, Ben, is talking.
That's actually true.
Yeah.
I can't really achieve maximum happiness without talking.
Which makes perfect sense.
Like, I like to talk while I eat.
Uh-huh.
I talk during sex. I talk all the time.
Like, I honestly don't like to talk all that often.
Will you put your keys on the goddamn table so your truck will make it? If anyone knows how to solve this key fob problem, Ray has a little key thing where you unlock and lock your car.
Yeah,
and
it's for a Ford truck.
No, it's a Dodge.
Dodge truck, sorry.
You're going to piss half the people off there. Yeah. We're talking about it.
I do know there's a Dodge and a Ford.
See, that's interesting, though.
Whenever I think about truck.
Now we bring up what makes you happy.
Well,
pissing people off.
whenever I think of a truck fucking up, I think Ford. Like, automatically. And so I said Ford. But no, it is a Dodge. It's a great truck, as all Dodge trucks are. But this key fob, like, it got crushed at some point or something, and then my brother-in-law tried to fix it, and he just fucked it up worse.
Yeah.
So now it can lower my windows, but there's no button for that, so it just does whatever it wants to. It locks the if you breathe on it, and I'm literally saying if you breathe too hard on it, it will lock the doors and make a little beep sound, and it does that over and over again. It'll do it like 3-4 dozen times in a row. And so, yeah, my key's on the counter now. The table now, just to keep it from doing that and distracting me. If anybody knows a fix for that, or where, like, I'm trying to, I don't want to give more money to a dealership. Like, does that make any sense to you guys? Like, I get so tired of paying dealerships.
Yeah.
And so I'm like, is there any, can I program a key fob?
You probably need to go on the YouTubes.
Yeah, I may have to go on the YouTubes.
I bet they have an answer.
YouTube answers everything. But
I remember, so back to Ben's happiness.
Yeah, Ben's happiness.
Ben's happiness for a minute. I remember, I think it was shortly after I got married. So my wife and I did not wait for marriage to have relations biblically.
Oh, that is a sin. All sins are equal in Jesus' eyes. You might as well have killed your father.
Yes. Sometimes I think about that, but in this case, we're talking about happiness. And so we started knowing each other biblically well before we were married.
But you had perfect intention to get married at the time.
Yeah, no, we were getting married.
Yeah.
I mean, it wasn't like, oh, well, I might not marry you. It was like, no. I mean, from where I come from, right,
mm-hmm.
sleeping with a person and then not marrying them is actually a greater sin than homosexuality.
Yes. I think that's probably a greater sin than murdering a kitten.
I think so. Yeah. No. And I think it's a deeply Southern thing. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So when I was, you know, as we said it in my family, when I was biblical with a person for the first time,
mm-hmm.
When I knew them biblically, I was in. I didn't have any other choice. You know.
Right. Right.
And so. You know, that's a whole nother story for another time. But where I was going with this was I talk all the time.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? And so I think it was not brought up during our engagement, right?
Okay.
But I still remember, like, it was maybe like the third or fourth day we got married and moved into our house the next day.
Right.
Well, we went on our honeymoon.
We went on honeymoon and then came back.
Came back and moved into our house, right? Yeah. So I think it was the third or fourth day that we were back at our house, and you know, we were in the bed,
and we were
doing the thing, and there was sunlight streaming in the windows, and we had this great room with like a western exposure, and it looked down on this little creek. It was fucking. It was a cheap rent house. Like uh-huh. it was the best I could find, but it was, you know, it was an inexpensive rent house.
Right.
You know, there was a terrible, like, if it got, like, right now, it'd be 30 degrees in that house.
Right.
You know, it was colder than the outside somehow.
Right,
you know,
yeah.
Or hotter than the outside somehow. You go outside and you'd be like, how is outside better than the house?
Yeah, it happens a lot
yeah.
in Texas. I don't know why that is.
So we're there and we're doing the thing, and I still remember the look on Sarah's face, and I'm like, oh God, you know, I'm like 12 days into marriage,
right?
You know, and I still remember the look on her face, and I'm like, what did I do wrong? You know,
right.
Like, oh God, like I'm getting that look, like, and it's not the angry look, and it's not the mad look. It's more of a, can I say this look?
Uh-huh.
You know, like she's questioning something in her mind. Which again, when you have your penis out, that is not a good time that look.
That's a terrible look.
Yeah.
She's like, is it supposed to be that short?
Right. Yeah. And so I'm like,
that's a weird color, isn't it? Does nature make that color?
I'm like, hey, what's wrong? And she's like, well, would it be possible for you not to talk?
Can you please shut the fuck up so I can get this nut for crying out loud?
So I proceeded not to talk. And then I was like, you know, and then I was like, hey, I got to go out later, so I'm going to go get a shower. And then I went and cried in the shower for like 2 hours.
Can you please shut your goddamn mouth so I can concentrate? That's a great story. I'm sorry,
if we're being honest, are any of my stories not good? Come on.
They're all great. Yeah, gold.
Yeah, all I can tell you is that's how I remember it. She probably remembers it differently. That's not shocking. That happens a lot.
I bet it happened just that way, though.
Yeah.
I bet she was like, can you please?
What if you didn't use your words, right?
I love you.
Right.
I like what you're doing.
Right, right.
If you could just stop with the color commentary.
Right, yeah.
I know I'm beautiful.
If you could just shut the fuck up.
Your voice is a turn off. No, and that's one of the things. Like, dude, I love to talk too. But I hate the sound of my voice. Like, I love to talk, but I don't like to hear myself. And so I'm just like Sarah. I'm like, I'm going to have to be quiet while I do this. I like to hear my partner. If they want to make comments, maybe a adulation. Maybe, hey, there you
make
go.
Make some noise.
Attaboy. Oh. You know, I accept those. But I don't like, if I do talk, it's always under my breath or very low. You know, it's short sentences. I'm not trying to carry on a conversation. That was at the beginning. Now, of course, I've been married for, going on 20 years. And so sex is you've got to do stuff all the time in a marriage. And so you kind of multitask.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you're having sex. And you're also discussing about, you know, the kids' lessons plans. And because we homeschool.
Mm-hmm.
And you're, you know. About how are you gonna do this this year's holidays, this vacation?
Get off me! I'm trying to do the dishes.
No. I don't like that's the other thing. Like I don't like to have sex in the kitchen.
Yeah, that's right. That's
I think we've already had that discussion.
Flavor Ray's rules.
That's a no-no.
The kitchen is the champagne room for Flavor Ray.
Exactly. ain't no sex in the champagne room. But I completely understand both sides of that equation is what I'm trying to say.
Yeah.
I completely understand that it makes you happy,
sure,
to speak.
Yeah.
And I really understand that it makes her happy for you not to.
Yeah.
That also makes sense to me.
Well, and I think, you went to high school with her, so you actually knew her during that time better than me. Some of it is just
I don't think I knew her better than you.
Some of it is her Italian heritage. You know,
yeah.
they're a very stoic people, you know. What's wrong?
Mike lost all of his shit.
I don't think I know one person from an Italian fucking family that would agree with what you just said.
Well,
they're very loud people.
They're loud, but
they're loud. They're big huggers.
But it's at a time. You know, everything for the Italians I know, everything has a time and a place.
They're big on tradition.
Yes. And so like there are certain
norms, manners, norms.
Yeah.
Things like
so
that.
For instance, like when you enter a restaurant, not the time to be loud. when you see your buddies at the bar in the restaurant.
Those hands better be in the air.
Time to be loud. You see what I'm saying? Like, we got to, but as we walk in, we're like the definition of stoicism.
Right.
You know? But as soon as we see that dude we know, or the chef, or what the fuck ever,
yeah,
food, or I don't know, a table, we're like, okay, now it's on.
Right.
You know? Like, so I agree with y'all, but I just, yeah, I think some of that is just like there's a time and a place for things. And, you know, talking is not everywhere.
Talking during pillow talk, sexy time, is not. But
also, to be fair, like I talk in church when I went to church. I talk
in. And got in trouble?
I talk in the courtroom. You know, when they tell you, like, you know, the judge is like, I need everyone to be quiet as we hear the opening arguments. I'm like, well, this is going to go well.
Right.
I pretty much, those awkward moments at a wedding.
Yeah.
I'm like, you know, I look to my left, look to my right. I'm like, is anybody else feeling awkward here? Like, are they going to do this thing? Or, you know, like, whenever I feel nervous or whenever I feel happy or whenever I feel sad or whenever I feel anything, really, I talk.
And that's pursuing your happiness at all times. Like, that's one of the things about happiness that I think is lost in the in the kerfuffle of our lives, is that happiness is something that can be pursued continually.
Yeah.
It cannot be achieved continually.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we can't live our lives being perpetually happy, but we can definitely live our lives perpetually pursuing happiness.
Sure.
You know, like, a lot of people are very lucky, like you, and you get to do the thing that makes you happy the most for a living.
Mm-hmm.
You know, a lot of people don't get that.
Yeah.
You know, and that's a huge blessing that people always are always trying to get people to do. Mm-hmm. You know, it was like, do what makes you happy and you never work a day in your life.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that sort of thing. And I agree with it. But at the same time, there are other things that also make you happy that you can do, even if your job isn't the thing.
Mm-hmm.
Like, one of the things that makes me happy, personally makes me happy, is reading.
Okay.
You know, yeah. I love to read. I love to read stories because I consume stories so fully. It's literally like
one of the things that's going to make you happy right now is to take a quick break.
You're correct. You did take a quick break, and we'll be right back. And your graphic tattoo with children. We took a little break, and one of the things that makes Pirate Man happy, you might not know this, is fashion. He really enjoys taking chances on his clothes and trying new shoes and changing his look every once in a while. And now he is now wearing a very smart-looking, long-sleeve Amazon shirt that just got here from Jeff Bezos himself. Yeah. I think Jeff Bezos. Was that Jeff Bezos outside?
Yeah, it was. It's pretty dope. It's very soft.
It looks great.
Yeah.
Like, honestly, his like, now, he took off his hoodie and the little undershirt he had on.
Yeah.
And so he was, like, you know, damn near butt-ass naked in the middle of the studio.
Yeah.
But that's not unusual for men.
No.
And then he puts on this shirt, and now he looks literally ready to go on NPR.
Like, yeah. I look unusually professional.
Yeah. That's what I'm saying. Like, that shirt changed your whole look. Like, I can't see the crow. Like, look at this cat. I'm going to take a picture, and I'm going to post it on social media. You guys are going to see what I'm talking about.
Yeah, that's one of the things that makes me happy also, because, you know, and I've talked about this some on social media, is I grew up where, you know, in a family where any nudity was bad.
Right.
So, like, that would be like an exposed leg nudity.
You know, right. Like, exposed. So I can see your dirty thigh there,
right,
Ben.
Right. I can see your dirty elbow. Your filthy fucking elbow. So, yeah, nudity was frowned upon. So now the older I get, you know, I like tattoos, obviously, and I continue to get them.
Right.
And I've gotten a new one this week. I got a new one last week. I got a new one the week before that. and I just, I don't have the same principles that I had before. I just like to get naked sometimes.
Like, well, I mean, there's a, probably a 30% chance you drive up to 302 Mantooth, you'll see Ben outside with his shirt off and a pair of shorts.
Yeah. Well, in the summer.
In the summer, yeah.
Not in the 30-degree shade, 90-degree sun, right?
Yeah.
Not whatever's happening right now.
Yeah, this fuck-up out here... I'll get to the word later. I'm talking about happiness. I'm keeping it positive today.
Keep it positive, Frank.
So we were talking about me and reading. Yeah, I like to read, but more than that, I like to consume stories.
Okay.
And so there are different ways. Like you can get stories through a movie or through a television show, but I find that reading, there's something magical about reading.
Mm-hmm.
Where a person had a thought in their head, and so they put it onto a page, and now I read that page, and that thought is now in my head. So it's like telepathy to me.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's a connection with the author. And if it's a many people reading it, then we all are connected in the same world.
Mm-hmm.
Like, this is just how I think. But, you know, in the modern world, picking up a book... You know, with all of its pages and the spine and the folderol, it's a little cumbersome when we're moving this fast. You know, if it could just, and ebooks, like, you know, the, what is that? What's the program all the books are on?
Kindle.
Kindle, yes. Reading that way, while it feels futuristic, it still feels a little cumbersome. You know, like, I really... Because it's like a long-form book. But there's a format in the world called... Wuxia novels. So they're novels from China. They're being translated into English. And they come out in episodic chapters as they go along translating these chapters. And so each chapter is only, you know, a few pages. They actually count the length of the book by characters. And so it's many characters, but in Chinese. But it's not that long in English. And so you crack this thing open. They have many websites that host these web novels. And it's a perfect way for me to read.
Mm-hmm.
Like I can do it at work. I can do it in my car. I can, you know, if you see me stopped at a long red light, I'll probably crack one open and start reading.
Really?
Like, it's such a great, because the stories themselves are so dense with meaning. Mm-hmm. Like, it's the perfect thing for me, who's always looking for meaning mm-hmm. in stories. Mm-hmm. And these stories are always trying to convey a different level of meaning.
Yeah.
And so I'm constantly reading these things, and like
as your therapist, I have to interject.
Uh huh.
You know, you're looking for yourself, right?
Of course. Of course, I'm looking for me, but I'm not finding me.
Continue.
I'm finding a Chinese version of me.
Continue the Wushu novel story.
But the thing about it is that it makes me happy for that period of time that I'm reading it.
Yeah.
Like, you know, I mean, I'm stepping outside of my culture.
Are you, Trent, when you read a book, this is something interesting about reading. When you read a book, are you there?
Yes.
See, that's something I think some people don't have.
That it's true.
You some and I are incredibly lucky.
Yeah.
Because when I read a book, I'm there.
Yes.
Like, I can feel the air and the snap and the crickets.
Yes, exactly.
And, like, I can hear it, and I can, like, I'm there.
That's part of the reason why I love it when you're reading a story and all of a sudden they just throw in a sex scene. So I'm like, you know, I'm going through, and it's like, there's a good little story, and things like that. Oh, now I'm fucking. This is great.
Wow, that's weird. I guess I'm not reading that. Is that a Wushu novel thing?
It happens very rarely in Wuxia. Like, okay. The Chinese are so reserved.
That's what I thought.
It's like, what they'll say is, it's so interesting. It's so interesting. After you read these things for a few dozen of them, you'll start recognizing some of their little quirks of language.
Mm-hmm.
And they'll say, like, and then they looked at each other, and her ears turned red, and suddenly a scene of spring bloomed.
Wow.
And then to the next.
Wow.
And so, yeah.
And they got biblical.
Yeah, yeah. Okay. It happened, but right. that's much I said about it.
Yeah, okay.
You know, right. There's, like, the ones where they get down into the nitty-gritty and start describing it, like, those are just smut. You know, this is, and even then, it's only, like, and she exposed her nipple. Like, her nipple?
Right.
Yeah, that sort of thing.
Her dirty, filthy elbow.
How on earth can they put this on the internet in China?
Right.
They really can't.
Can we say thank you? Because one of the things that makes us happy is Standpipe Coffee House. And yes. I mean that. This is not a paid-for advertisement.
It is
But St. David Inc. went and got us coffee. And for that, I would like to say thank you, everyone listening. Please go check out St. David Inc. on Instagram and Facebook and probably even TikTok.
Guys, if you live in Lufkin, Texas, and are not enjoying Standpipe Coffee, you're really doing yourself a disservice. Like, Starbucks is okay.
Sure.
They'll get you by.
Yeah.
But Standpipe is on another level, guys. Like, I'm not just saying that because I was part of the company.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I haven't worked there in a number of years.
Well, those were dark times.
But, you know, when I was there, it wasn't great
at all. But to clarify, they weren't dark times because Ray was working there.
No, they were dark times because I was going through a lot of things. And so Ray would come in the morning and find me asleep behind the counter. And,
yeah.
Yeah, mm-hmm. it was dark times.
It was definitely, it was rough. It was
there
rough.
Were, there were more than a few days when I had to text Ray and say, hey, come down. And he would be like, why? And I would be like, because I'm drunk.
I remember one time very specifically. I walked in because it was, I was just driving by.
Mm-hmm.
I walked into the side door and Ben was literally, we had a little office desk set up in the side of the building.
Mm-hmm.
And he was slumped over that desk, dead asleep. Mm-hmm. I looked up and six people walked in.
Yeah.
So I jumped, and he was the only one working.
Right.
So I jumped behind the counter and literally 3 hours of rush later, Ben wakes up and goes, hey man, how you doing?
Yeah, what's going on?
I'm like, fuck you and go back to sleep, asshole.
Yeah.
It's over now.
It's done.
Yeah, Ray like...
So
Ray,
I had to learn how to open the coffee shop. This is prior to the dark times, but I learned how to open the coffee shop because I would get down there, you know, and you'd show up on the motorcycle pretty close, and I was like, all right, let's get this rolling.
Yeah, Ben just ran a motorcycle.
Yeah, that was a long time
ago. Oh, my God. There's so many things have changed. All right. So, I like to read because I can do it all the time. I can pursue it continually. Like that's my I think my weird add-on to happiness is that it can be pursued all the time, and I don't think that we celebrate that enough.
Yeah.
The fact that we can pursue happiness like my wife is one of the best in the world at pursuing happiness.
Mm-hmm.
Because she'll take a lunch break.
Yeah.
And so she'll go and make sure that she can eat something really quick and then spend the rest of her lunch break going for a run.
Yeah.
You know?
Because running makes her happy. Okay.
And you know, she'll get up on a Sunday morning, like earlier than she needs to get up on a Sunday.
Mm-hmm.
Just get up before the kids and go run a 5K.
Yeah.
And come back and be just fantastic.
Mike, what about happiness?
I like figuring shit out.
Okay.
Like, it literally is the thing that makes me happy. If I can figure something out.
So before you can be happy, you got to have a problem. There's got to be something wrong with the world first.
No. I don't have to figure out necessarily a problem, right? Yeah. But
So you're just figuring out.
Like, if I didn't know how the inner workings. Phone worked.
Yeah, the inner workings of something.
I would want to, how does that work, right? Or if someone said, you know, I was successfully able to post to social media, all platforms, 10 times a day. But, like, how the fuck does that work?
Mm-hmm. Now, is it because you are the process of figuring out that makes you happy? Or is it the gaining of the knowledge that makes you happy? The gaining of the information?
I think it's part... I think it's adrenaline rush, honestly.
Okay.
It's like a weird adrenaline rush.
Okay.
That... when I see all the pieces snap together and it works, right?
Mm-hmm.
That I figured it out. I have that evidence that I figured it out. There's almost an endorphin release, an adrenaline rush there.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I hear you.
And maybe it's the adrenaline rush is what I'm, you know, the reward center I'm going for, you know, because
yeah,
also
that's what I have to say.
Driving really fast in the wrong lane of the road does something similar.
When kids, I'm in a bad mood. If you're listening, don't do that.
Don't do that. That's wrong way. I think, in that case, is it happiness? This is my question there. Is that happiness or is it more addiction?
I don't know. I think there are different forms, and we're all at different places. But the fact that you can say problem solving makes me mm-hmm. happy.
Yeah,
I think that's a very different thing, maybe than your, because driving in the wrong lane, while it may have been an adrenaline
rush.
It's
an adrenaline rush that makes you feel tingly and makes you feel alive. Yeah,
correct.
So that would be different
than... It's a similar feeling,
yes.
That adrenaline rush yes. that I get yeah, yeah. when I figure something out.
Yes.
Right?
Yeah. Okay.
When I solve a problem, I get some sort of
yeah.
chemical rush
right.
in the brain.
Yeah, I mean, I think all our sensations can be traced back to some chemical somewhere in the brain.
Sure.
Which is fine. But I think I don't think skydiving per se
yeah.
is a happiness exercise.
It might be.
I mean, it could be for some people.
It could
like,
be.
But those people do it for, you know, they do it all the time.
They,
if you were like, you know, I'm going to go on vacation skydiving, you're not doing it to make yourself happy. You're doing it to have an experience.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you're doing it for the rush. You're doing it for the thrill. You're doing it to say that you did it.
Hmm.
But and you get all of that out of it, but it's not necessarily a happiness exercise.
Interesting.
I think happiness is more of a like I don't think happiness is a momentary feeling per se. I think it is a thing. It's a daily pursuit. Hmm. Does that make any sense?
I mean,
that's what slipped up there. I might have fucked up there.
No, I don't think you fucked up necessarily. It might just be one side of it. Depending on what kind of triangle we're working around here. I think that is a big part of it, though, is that we definitely do those things to get to achieve.
I think feeling. Like I would say, say you went on a vacation and then part of the vacation was skydiving.
Mm-hmm.
I wouldn't say the skydiving was necessarily a happiness exercise, but the vacation itself was
mm-hmm.
the happiness exercise.
Okay,
you know, like I'm taking a vacation to more directly pursue the thing that makes me happy,
mm-hmm.
the stuff that makes me happy, the practice that makes me happy.
Mm-hmm.
And it's, you know, okay, I went skydiving and I went rock climbing and I, you know, I shook hands with the Pope. You know, I mean, all of those things were a equal exercise within the big exercise. The big exercise being the pursuing of the happy.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I'm trying to convey a thought I haven't worked out yet, if you couldn't tell, dear listeners. This is what I do.
I feel like... And my feelings are known to be very wrong, but I feel like there's an important aspect to what you're saying in trying to draw the difference between the idea of what actually makes us happy and the acts we do in pursuit of that. The acts themselves aren't what makes us happy.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
You know? They can contribute towards an overall sense of happiness.
Yes, they're a part of the puzzle to our happiness.
But there's a higher level thing. There's a higher level thought. Just like we were saying, you know,
like Ben like to read, but read
likes
make
to
me happy.
Talk.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yes.
Okay. It doesn't matter when, where, how, or why. Right.
Right.
He just likes to talk.
Mm-hmm.
In essence. Ben could probably be happy in an asylum somewhere.
Yeah, talking.
Just talking.
Yeah.
Okay.
I could be happy in prison.
Yeah.
I could be happy in a courtroom.
I could be pretty happy sitting there anywhere
mm-hmm.
with just stuff to tinker with, figure out how it works, and
yeah.
And I can be happy with a stack of books in front of me.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
In the same vein.
Wikipedia says the term happiness is used in the context of mental or emotional states, including positive or pleasant emotions ranging from contentment to intense joy. It is also used in the context of life satisfaction, well-being, eudaimonia, and flourishing.
Goddamn, he actually said a word I didn't know that time. What is eudaimonia?
It's a Greek word commonly translated as happiness or welfare. However, human prosperity or blessedness have been proposed as accurate translations.
I have no problem with that definition. I have a big problem with the word. Why the fuck would you ever say that word?
Well, okay, so I was going to get to that. The etymology, it consists of, and again, we're in Greek here. It consists of the word EU, which translates to good, and daemon, or demon.
Demon.
Which is spirit.
Yeah.
So good spirit.
Good spirit.
Is, I don't know that I'm...
Or good demon.
Look at the top there. What?
No, you almost hit it directly on the.
I went to the school for kids who can't read good.
Eudaimonia. Eudaimonia is as close as it get. Sometimes anglicized eudaimonia or eudaimonia. So good demon.
Yeah, you know that's good an spirit, interesting.
Good
demon,
flourishing prosperity.
It's an interesting thing because that's coming up more. The term it's spelled D-A-I-M-O-N.
Yeah.
That term, I've been seeing it a lot more.
Daemon.
Daemon.
Yeah. Daemon means spirit. There's a similar sort of word in like Japanese, I think, as a
it's in a lot of culture. But anyway, let's stick with happiness.
But yeah, well, we are sticking. Like, well, dude, I'm tripping up on this word because like, there is a synonym for it for virtue or excellence. Like, why in English do we look for the most dumb, complicated words? I mean, that's just not a word. It's in Greek. Okay, the Greeks can use their words. Why we got to try and steal that shit and bring it to English? It doesn't make any goddamn sense to use that word.
Mm. Mm. Makes perfect sense.
Why?
What was that movie with Robin Williams?
They got a bunch of those.
Yeah.
Hook?
No, what's that one?
He's talking about What Dreams May Come.
What Dreams May Come?
Maybe. I don't know. It was Good Will Hunting.
Oh,
good. That was my next guess. Actually, was Good Will Hunting because why not?
Yeah, it's in there, I believe. I don't know if it was that one. It was one of his movies where he is a teacher. Okay,
Dead Poet Society,
and he's teaching about language.
Dead Poet Society.
Dead Poet Society. Okay, yes, that's what. So. He's telling all these guys in class that the entire point of the English language, right, is to impress women.
Yeah, okay? I remember that conversation.
So it still may classify as dumb for Flavor Ray.
Yeah.
Right? But it is still, I think, a completely valid reason, seeing as how a core thing for all human beings is procreation.
What I love about that is that he was playing a character in academia, and that's like the only place where that word would be considered anything other than a fuck you to everyone in the room.
Hmm.
Like the only reason, if you're at a dinner table, someone goes, guys, we are experiencing a moment of eudaimonia. Everyone at the table is perfectly valid in throwing their drink in that guy's face.
Yeah, that's true.
You know, if he was there with a bunch of professors, even if they don't know what the fuck he's talking about,
right?
It's a bravo.
Yeah,
good job for using one of those words we pay so much fucking money to learn,
right?
And trick other people into thinking they need to learn too,
right?
All right, see, I keep doing this. I keep getting off topic and going to that dark territory. God, that's a bad habit.
Yeah,
it's a bad pattern. All right, I'm talking about happy.
Well, it's a habit that I would argue that we need to observe more, because one of the things that most religions seem to point to, or philosophies even, if you will,
sure,
is that one cannot make a change until one can see a change.
Right.
And I think that's one of the problems with living in a modern age, you know, and technology, is that we glance over these things so quickly now that the speed of life has moved up. Mm-hmm. And so you say that's a bad habit, and I want to if you were to say that's a bad habit and I want to change it, I think it would actually require you looking at it for more than 5 minutes.
Yeah, I've got to live it for a while.
We'd have to establish
I've only got, 42 episodes in?
Yeah.
I'm going to need at least 42 more.
I mean, if you're serious about it, Flavor Ray, we should establish a safe word. And we have the perfect one.
Okay.
Right?
Okay.
That if Ben or I see you going down dark territory.
Right.
Okay? We look at each other and then simultaneously say, ha, penis.
I was really hoping you were going to go with eudaimonia.
That could be a trigger word.
Like hey, how's your day going? Like, oh man, I've got pneumonia. Eudaimonia.
Eudaimonia. No, eudaimonia.
No. Eudaimonia.
Guys.
Okay.
Nipsey out there just squatting down right in front of the window. Yeah. That should make everyone laugh.
That's all good. I can't see it, but yeah, the Dos Copper Squad.
So let's take, but in all seriousness, let's keep rolling with this. What else? Besides reading, besides all the things we've talked about,
I'm gonna try and twist this into as many directions as I can. But I'm gonna let me think about this for just a second. We're gonna take a quick break. Everybody dancing, dog, y'all on that X. I'm a sentinel, standing tall. No time to stand still, please don't meander, dog. They're throwing jazz at me to challenge my rap savvy. I sway like Callaway, I'm a hater. And you're back to that too with children. We're talking about happiness and the things that make us happy. One of the things that makes me happy is uncomfortable conversation. Like Ben mentioned earlier that I like pissing people off. That's not true at all. I don't like pissing people off. But I do like having conversations that people don't like having.
Mm-hmm.
Because one, I believe that it's a service, and I love doing things that are useful.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that having uncomfortable conversations is a useful service that people don't do often enough.
So I automatically then, the first time we met, did the thing that endeared me to you forever.
Immediately. See, that's now you get it, right?
Okay.
Like, the reason why I was stunned the first time I met Ben, because Ben goes, I've never had a black friend before.
Right.
And immediate uncomfortable conversation.
Everyone in the world besides me is like, what the fuck is that to say to the person you just met? And I'm going, go on.
Tell me more.
You, sir, have opened the door. No, it was great.
And so now you have my attention.
And so I like having uncomfortable conversations. And so I like talking to, like, you know, I like talking to Democrats in front of Trump supporters.
Yeah,
you know, I like it when a person's like, yeah, that's my ex. Really? Let's go say hi.
Yeah,
you know, like that shit thrills me.
Yeah.
I know that's something that affects you. The listener, a bit more than somebody not listening to me. You the listener are oftentimes just kind of a passenger on this crazy train that I'm going down, just because I'm actually just grinning ear to ear at the fact of just how uncomfortable this conversation is with you, the person listening, and so like I don't. This is sort of an apology for bringing you into this.
Except that you're too happy about it.
But I'm thrilled about
it. Like you really need to go back behind the screen and like work on your sad face.
This is very much a hashtag sorry not sorry.
Right. So what I'm saying here is that I love podcasting. Podcasting is actually making me happy.
Yeah. It allows you to have uncomfortable conversations and then have a record of them.
And then be able to go back and listen to it again.
Yeah.
And then I relive the conversation and I get happy all over again.
Right. Or you realize places it needed to go or could have gone.
Yeah.
Or you want it to go.
Yes.
And you can then have future uncomfortable conversations.
For example, while we were on break, just for a moment, Ben lapsed into melody of I Believe I Can Fly, which immediately brought up R. Kelly, which immediately reminded me that R. Kelly's music actually is one of the things that makes me happy.
Yeah.
Like, instantly.
Right.
You know, I mean, that's, like,
is
I don't know.
Is R. Kelly really the one that did I Believe I Can Fly?
Yes.
Holy shit.
Like, isn't he that fucking good?
That's amazing.
Dude, like, y'all don't understand. Ever since 12 Play came out, I knew that R. Kelly's music was a thrill to my soul.
Yeah.
You know, I remember in 8th grade Spring Fest. Hey guys from Lufkin, Texas, graduated in 1997. You remember that 8th grade Spring Fest when we were all kind of against the wall and no one, because it was East and West, we hadn't seen each other in a long time. We weren't quite sure how to go.
Yeah, they were different schools. People don't remember that.
That's what I'm saying. You got to be old. You got to be an old fuck at this point. We were all against the wall. We didn't know quite how this was going to go. People had told us about Spring Fest. We didn't know actually what it was. I was wearing a vest. A multicolored vest, because I was that fucking cool. And then all of a sudden, the DJ, whoever it was, the genius that he was, broke out, my, gentlemen, no! And all of a sudden, we all understood, I know what they want us to do. And then it was on, people.
Yeah.
Like, that's what R. Kelly means to me.
So, interestingly enough, going into song, so one of the things that makes me happy, and I got this, I think I got this from my dad, I'm not sure, but I like to take songs and put different words to them.
You know, my wife does the exact same thing, and it makes her so happy to do it.
Generally, very sexual, inappropriate words.
Yes.
So, for instance, like, have you ever heard Willie Nelson's On the Road Again?
On the Road Again?
Yeah, exactly. Like a Band of Gypsies, We Go Down the Highway. Okay, so the other night, I'm driving around running errands, and I rewrote the entire song to On the Hoe Again. like a band of porn stars. And it got worse, and it got worse from there. And when I say it got worse from there, like, I literally rewrote every verse graphically horrendous. And I'm doing it just as I'm driving. Right.
So I really honestly think we should go ahead and pull up the karaoke at some point on the YouTube.
No, I do not think we should do that.
And have somebody record these lyrics that you wrote.
That sounds horrible.
Yeah, no, it's a terrible. Mike, what's happiness
actually
for you?
Another thing that that actually kind of ties into what Flavor Ray was saying, chagrin. I'm going to use one of those professor words.
Okay.
The feeling of chagrin makes me happy.
Okay.
Interesting.
Give a crap if it's something that's on my side, if it's something that's not on my side, if it meets my personal beliefs or does not, right?
Uh-huh.
When I can see and honestly feel an honest example of chagrin.
I'm not familiar. I'm familiar with the word, but I wouldn't be able to tell you an example of it.
Sure.
Because it's not embarrassment.
No, it's not. It's go ahead.
It is when it has two sides.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Right? The dictionary definition for a noun of it is distress or embarrassment at having failed or been humiliated.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. The verb is to feel distressed or humiliated. Mm-hmm. I as an observer, right?
Mm-hmm.
Absolutely, honestly love that because chagrin is more about deservedness of that embarrassment.
So like, would you say then, could I describe it slightly differently and say the dawning moment or the awareness is what that you like about the chagrin?
Yes.
Like that's kind of what it is. It's that moment when it's sort of like walking down the street naked and not knowing you're naked.
Mm-hmm.
The man goes, hey, man, Nice dick.
Yeah, you've been trailing that toilet paper throughout the entire Walmart.
Yes.
Yeah, okay.
That's sugar in.
Okay, and you're like, oh, my God, now everyone knows. Okay, fine. Yeah, this is me.
Yeah, exactly.
I'll be sitting there, and I'll just little moments in the news. Mm. You get that news headline that is this person is now a victim of something that they've been saying doesn't exist for years and years and years.
Right.
I'm just so happy to read that headline.
Yeah.
Right in that moment, I'm like, this is a person who absolutely 100% honestly deserved everything they got.
Getting hoisted by your own petard.
Yeah, I got you. Okay.
I'm not like Mike Payne over here. I do not take joy in the pain of others. You know, my Christian upbringing prevents that from happening. But I don't begrudge anybody their happiness.
God damn it! I just got fucking roasted for it.
Okay. I didn't mean to do that too. You know what? All right, guys. This is a deep subject, obviously, and this is actually a fun one.
Hit us up on social.
Tell us what your happiness is. Tell us the things that. Tell us your habits that you use to pursue happiness throughout your life. Like, I'm very interested in this whole topic. And I think it's one of those topics that we need to have that it isn't so harsh. So, just hit us up and we'll get back with you, all right? You've been listening to Tattoo with Children. I've been your host, Flavor Ray. You can find Tattoo with Children on Facebook at Tattoo with Children. And on Instagram at Tattoo with Children. You can find us on Twitter at Tattooed With. You can find me on Twitter at Hunter Vanguard. That's one word, Hunter Vanguard. You can find Ben at Instagram at Black Crow Brother. At Black Crow Brother. And you can find him at Black Spot Tattoo Company. You can find me on Instagram at Madara Shadow. You can find Mike Payne at CIO Payne on Instagram and at Payne.point on Instagram. That is Payne spelled P-A-Y-N-E. Guys, pursue happiness with your utmost gusto, and remember to take care of yourself before you take care of others.
Later.
Take it. Travel to the core is a normal placement.